viewing a message from the pulpit of Rolling Hills Church, located in Verona, Pennsylvania. We're glad that you could join us as we open up the Word of God.
Satan wants you to believe that God will not give you more than you can handle. That is Satan. That is not Scripture.
All right, everyone, if you can take your seats, we're going to take a little bit of time here and celebrate a very important aspect, part of our church, a very important ministry, and that is our children's ministry. So you see we have a plethora of children lined up here. It's a little scary to look out and see them all like right here in the front looking at me. But I think you'll be very blessed to see what God and to hear what God is doing through the lives of these children, how God is growing their hearts to be more like Him, and the other lives that they are able to touch. So I will call Cindy Stenger up, and she's going to give us a little bit of a context of why we're celebrating here this morning.
Good morning, and welcome to our Children's Ministry Day. We've been celebrating now for several years, and it's just a wonderful opportunity to recognize our children and our youth, because as Pastor Greg said, they are such an important part of our church family. And you know, they are not just the church of the future, but they are the church of today. And the theme this year is All for You. And the children have been encouraged and learning about how to give all of themselves to serve our Lord Jesus Christ in all that they do, and especially in some special ministry projects. And Nicole and Jolie are going to be sharing the things that the kids have done over the years. I'm sure all of us have been blessed by them, even without being involved in those special ministry projects, because they are certainly here and moving about in our midst in a lot of special ways. So what they did, in especially for this focus, in February, the children collected mittens and also some scarves and hats for one of our local clothing banks at New Vision Church, which is on Verona Road in Rosedale, and they have a once a month clothing bank. So the kids collected, I want to say close to, I think it was 70 or so that I counted. So a lot of kids were blessed, because we had some of that nice spring weather in February, but then we did get cold and snow. So I know that the pastor's wife there was very happy to receive those from our kids. And they're going to share other things that they've done throughout the year. You know, we want to be able to teach our kids, certainly by our example, as how we are serving the Lord. And it's, you know, we have this idea of what missions, quote, looks like, and it's not necessarily a focused event where we may be going and serving dinner or you know, other ways to be in our community, and those are very important. And actually, we did have one of our kids, Jacob, was able to serve at the dinner on Wednesday night at the church in Verona. They have a once a month community dinner, and Jacob, you were awesome. He was very polite and gracious and friendly, and he worked the entire time, and then was very happily rewarded with a piece of Miss Barb's strawberry shortcake that he worked for. So, and it was a great event. But our kids are just going to share and bless you today. So we look forward to hearing them, and they have some special things planned for you.
So So we do have a bunch of amazing students and kids here at Rolling Hills Church. We just love them so much. Before we share some of the servant opportunities or ministries that they've had a chance to partake in, I wanted to point out this yellow prayer. If you did not get a chance to get one, I encourage you to. I don't even know exactly where I got this prayer, so I can't even give credit to where it's due. I got it out of a book 20 years ago, and it was a prayer for kids, because at that time I was not a mother, I was a teacher, and Greg and I were just newly married, but this prayer was just amazing, and I know that we can just talk to God every day, just talking to Him, but I love this prayer. I would keep it in my Bible, and actually the original prayer, I have about 20 names of children that were my nieces and nephews. When I knew my cousins or sisters were having babies, I would add them to that list. So I would lift those names up to the Lord. I just think it's very powerful. So I would encourage you to grab one, hold on to it, stick it in your Bible and or your prayer journal, and when you're praying, it's just a great prayer. For our children, because they are up against so much at school and in their everyday lives, and they really need us, if anything, to be prayer warriors for them. So throughout the year, our kids have opportunities to serve many different ways and to be the hands and feet of Jesus, and these are just a few. In the summertime, we had the lemonade and cookie stand to raise money for Snaderline's birthday, our World Vision child, and for the Nepal earthquake relief. During VBS, we raised money for the women's shelter down in Trenum. During Kingdom Kids, we had an evening neighborhood prayer walk for our neighbors here. The kids did a wonderful job. We would walk up and down the streets, and they would just pray for the homes and the people that live there. The teenagers and the old and younger kids helped serve at the Fall Fun Fest games and doing different things, setting up, cleaning up. They made Thanksgiving cards and little turkeys for our friends at Seneca Place or Seneca Village next door. They read books to our elderly neighbors in the fall. A bunch of them came caroling with our church family at Seneca as well. And the toy drive at Christmas, when we were naming some things, I remember the kids saying, don't forget about the toy drive. Many of them gave up their toys and donated them so they could bless others at Christmas time.
And some of the other activities they did, they made Operation Christmas Child boxes and donations. So if you helped pack a box with toys. They, as Cindy said, they collected mittens and hot chocolate for those in need at the New Vision Church. And also with Kingdom Kids, they made bird feeders for our feathered friends, which Sadie enjoyed too. They also made cards for people who were ill in our church as well, or friends who weren't feeling well or broke their arm or needed some cheering up. They helped run the games for Easter Fun Day, and they also made special notes of encouragement and candy favors for our friends at the Verona Methodist Church meal. So each of those people who sat at that meal this past week had a little favor bag of candy and the nice notes of encouragement that you left at their place setting. And also last year in Kingdom Kids, they passed out popsicles and water bottles to people in the surrounding community for free at a park that we went to. And then they got to play afterwards, right? So now we're going to invite the children to come up. They're going to share some Bible verses, and they all want to encourage us through those Bible verses and some of the things that they have to say for all of us too to have servants' hearts like they did this past year.
Time all the children can line up. We have a few that are going to read some Bible verses about serving, and they're all going to share some random acts of kindness that we could do in our everyday lives. So Noah's going to start. We have six students that are going to be reading Bible verses for us.
Mark 10:45, for even the Son of Man came not to be served, but to serve, and to give his life as a ransom for many.
Peter 4:10, each of you should use whatever gift you have received to serve others, as faithful stewards of God's grace in its various forms.
Romans 10:12-13. Love must be sincere, hate what is evil, cling to what is good, be devoted to one another in brotherly love, honor one another above yourselves, never be lacking in zeal, but keep your spiritual fervor serving the Lord, be joyful in hope, patient in affliction, faithful in prayer, share with God's people who are in need, practice hospitality.
Isaiah chapter 58, verse 10. Feed the hungry and help those in trouble. Then your light will shine out from the darkness, and the darkness around you will be as bright as noon.
Matthew 25:40, and the king will say, I tell you the truth. When you did it to one of the least of these, my brothers and sisters, you were doing it to me.
First John 3:18, dear children, let us not love with words or speech, but with actions and in truth.
Random acts of kindness, pass it on.
Leave a book you have already finished somewhere for someone to read.
Give construction workers a cold drink.
Donate work clothes to a woman's shelter.
Write a letter to an elderly relative or a friend.
Let someone go in front of you in the checkup line.
Put something you no longer need on the Craigslist for free.
Pay for a Starbucks order behind you in the drive-thru.
Send a care package to a soldier.
Get the time.
Bring your old books to a homeless shelter.
Tape a bus fare sign to a bus stop.
Deliver a meal to someone.
Leave a kid's activity book with a note in the hospital waiting room.
Bring flowers to a nursing home.
Deposit coins in a parking meter.
Fill a backpack with school supplies and give to a local school.
Babysit for a new mom.
Leave your neighbor a sweet treat.
Donate blood.
Donate money to help a family adopt.
The kids, if I could have four friends, let's see, Reagan, DJ, do you want to help? Jacob? Oh no, you're going to play, that's right. Caleb. Reagan, Caleb, DJ, and Katie, could you help? We have some chocolate that they're going to bless you with. Miss Cindy's going to tell you a little bit about that. Then Eden and Renee have a song on the violin and viola for you, and Jacob is going to play piano piece for you.
If you're like me, you probably never really think that much about where the products come from that we purchase and the things that we use in our everyday lives. And very sadly to say that a lot is sourced through human trafficking and slavery. So the kids want to bless everyone with a little piece of chocolate to remember this sweet day. But also, it's just a reminder, when you're having this piece of chocolate, which is resourced slave-free, it's incredibly horrific what is happening in our world for the sake of profit. So when you are enjoying this piece of candy, please say a prayer, or keep in mind anytime you're having a treat, that to pray for the thousands and thousands of children that are enslaved to pick the cocoa beans that make our chocolate. And very sad that most of our major candy companies are not ethically resourcing their chocolate supply. So this actually is from Aldi's, and all of their chocolate is slave-free. So I was really happy to see that, because it's close by, it's reasonable, and most of us shop there. So please do keep those children and those that seek to rescue them and bring justice, because it really should not be for our expense, our comfort and convenience at the expense of someone's life. So enjoy your chocolate and pray. Thank you.
Well, guys, thank you so much for all of your work in helping with the many ministries of this church. Thank you for being the example to the adults of serving and not looking to always be served. And we're going to have a real quick time of prayer for the children's ministry. So if you would please join me in prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank you for children. We thank you for the blessing of being able to minister with the various children that you bring into our lives as a church. And God, we pray that you would help each and every one of our children to be safe as they go about their daily activities at school, at home, in the neighborhood. Lord, we pray that you would protect them, that you would guard their hearts and allow them to trust in you. And Lord, we pray that you would use them in many ways to be a light, to be an example to their schoolmates, their friends, and especially their family. God, may you use them to see the hope and the faith that we can have in you and the dependence that we can have on you. God, we thank you for the blessing that our children are. We thank you for all of those that help with ministering with these children. We pray that you would continue to give them the strength that they need and the excitement and the inspiration to continue to serve. God, we pray that each and every one of us would do exactly what you told us to do, Jesus, and to become like a child in regards to our relationship with you. It's in your name that we pray. Amen. All right, before you go back to your seats, we do have some a quick treat here if you want to grab. And there are activity bags out in the hallway. If you did not receive one of those, feel free to grab one. But a few of you, we need to use a couple of you to help our ushers. So those of you that are helping with the ushering today, do we know who they are, Nicole? Okay, we do know who they are. So those that are helping, if you could please hang out up here and wait, and we will have our ushers come forward.
Our most gracious Heavenly Father, we come before you this day in thanks for all your many blessings. We ask that you bless this offering, bless each gift and giver. Be with the pastor as he delivers a message. For we ask this in thy name. Amen.
think about it.
So this morning is a kids in church morning, which means that they will remain with us. So if you guys need to get with your parents and sit there, that's fine. Or if you want to sneak away and stay amongst yourselves, that's fine as well, but stay in here. God, we thank you once again for bringing us here this morning, and we ask now as we turn to your word that you would speak to us and that we would be obedient to that which you call us to. It's in your name we pray. Amen. You know, I was, anytime you have these children's things, it's always interesting how, what the thing I noticed that I thought was very interesting was how the times have changed. You know, 10 years ago, you would have had all these adults like lining up the front with their little camcorders, you know, and or these 20 years ago, it was with the obnoxious, you know, shoulder-mounted camera thing. And now it's like people just whip out their phone and they're like, oh, this is so much nicer. Just an interesting thought. For the past couple of weeks, we've been asking some difficult questions. We've asked things about, you know, can I really believe what I read in the Bible? Can God really forgive me of all of my sins? Does God want me happy all of the time? And why does God allow suffering and evil? And today we're going to deal with a very common one. It's not really a challenge or a question. It's more an issue of a lot of people just getting this particular issue wrong. So before we do that, let me ask a question, though. How many of you, you don't have to put your hands up, but if you want to, you can. If you need to put two hands up to really drive the point home. How many of you feel overwhelmed with life? You just feel like there are too many things going on. You feel stressed. You feel busy. What's funny today, if you ask someone, so how are you doing? One of the most common responses you will get from people are, oh, I'm busy. Well, how are you? Well, I'm busy. How have things been going? Oh, it's been busy, let me tell you. In our culture, it's kind of become the norm. It's become acceptable to be busy and overwhelmed. And it's better, it seems, to do that than to live life in the rhythms and the patterns that God has intended for us. If you feel overwhelmed, if you feel like there is too much that's going on, if you think that you are at that tipping point where it feels as if one more thing that is going to be added to your schedule and that's going to be the thing that sends you into the crazy bin, perhaps this morning's message is for you. So we're going to start off with a story of Moses in the Old Testament. In fact, if you look at the life of Moses, you see on more than one occasion where he felt completely overwhelmed, like there were too many things that were going on in his life. And this first story really ministers to me in many different ways, ways that I'm sure you will probably be able to relate with. So here's Moses. He's leading perhaps as many as 2 million people out of Egypt and across this desert, and they were crying out saying, we are sick and tired of this manna. Manna was this thing. Basically, the word manna means what is it? So the people that were eating it had no idea what it was, but it was this thing that would appear every morning, and God would provide it to take care of the needs for these Israelites. And so they get to the point where they are just crying out saying, we want some meat. And all the men are like, amen. And it's funny how this story fits into our message this week. Numbers 11, verses 13 through 14. Where can I get meat for all these people? Moses asked God. They keep wailing at me. They said, give us meat to eat. Now, you have to say that kind of like the Arby's guy in the new commercials, you know, give us meat, you know, kind of thing. And it's, you know, this would be a great, I don't know, I would think if some like Christian wanted to start a restaurant, you know, kind of have that as their slogan. It's a great line. It's an easy one for many of you to memorize from the Bible. Verse 14, you can hear Moses' frustrations come out. He says, I cannot carry all of these people by myself. The burden is too heavy for me. It's too much. I cannot go on. I'm overwhelmed. I cannot do it anymore. The burden is too heavy for me to carry. And as soon as Moses or someone else today would say something like that, some well-meaning Christian somewhere is going to come in and say this to you. Do not worry. Remember, God only gives you what you can handle. It's going to be okay. Everything happens for a reason. Do not give up. You can do it. God will never give you more than you can handle. You might see it on refrigerator magnets. You might see it on bumper stickers. See it on greeting cards. The guy on TV that's preaching, he might say something to that effect. Well-meaning Christians will say it time and time again. God will never give you more than you can handle. The problem is, that is nowhere in the Bible. It's not found anywhere in Scripture. It is a spiritual myth. It is a Christian urban legend. So where do we get this wrong belief from? Chances are, very well, that most people, when they are saying that God will only give you what you can handle, they are misinterpreting and misquoting a very important verse. 1 Corinthians 10:13 is the verse that most people are probably trying to quote, but they are missing it by like that much. The Apostle Paul, what's happening here is he said this about God. He said, you need to remember that God is always faithful, and God will not let you be tempted beyond what you can bear. But when you are tempted, God will also provide a way out. We never see anywhere in the Bible that it says that God will never give us more than we can handle. What we do see is God promising us we will never be tempted beyond what we can bear. You know, one of the jokes that I always make about this verse is that if I take this verse literally, which I do, it means that I guess that's why I'm not rich. Because God, looking at my life, says, you know what, Greg, you will not be able to handle having that kind of money, so don't worry. You'll never even be tempted to be rich. What it means is that no matter what Satan throws our way, no matter the temptation that he will put in our lives to take us out of the will of God, God will always, always give us an escape route every single time. What people should say is when they are being tempted, when they are about to sin, they should have someone that comes up to them and says, hey, do not worry about this. God will not let you be tempted beyond what you can handle. If you are being tempted in this, that means that you can handle it. It means that God has given you a way out. He has allowed a way for you to escape. And that is a whole sermon in and of itself. But hear that again, that you can handle the temptation to get angry. You can handle the temptation to drink. You can handle the temptation to see those things on the computer screen that you should not be looking at. God will give us the strength to defeat those temptations and to flee from them. He will give us a way out. He will put people into our lives in which we can be accountable to. Here comes the discipleship thing, where we can be accountable to them and call them up or ask them, hey, will you pray for me? I need help in this. He will provide a way out. The truth is, though, when we are talking about burdens in life, the truth is this, that God will often allow us to have far more than we can handle in our life. He can give us the gift of too much. Why would he do this? Why would God allow us? Why would he give us the gift of too much? Because he is going to teach us something. He is going to allow us to learn how to depend on something besides ourselves. The spiritual myth that God will never give us more than we can handle, what that basically says to us is pull your bootstraps up. You can do this if you just try, you know, and here comes the water boy reference, you can do it kind of thing. We have this idea that if we just try harder, if we handle it ourselves, God will allow us then to handle whatever weights and difficulties are in our lives. But the truth is, God allows us to have more than we can handle so that we can learn to depend on other people, and ultimately, so that we can learn how to depend on His strength. So a lot of people will also say things like this, well, you know, God will allow you to bend. I know that life is difficult right now. God will allow you to bend, but He is never going to break you. That has never been my experience with God. No, God loves it when His children are broken before Him. When we get to that point where we cannot handle things on our own anymore, where we have exhausted every single one of our resources, and so that all that we can do is look up to God and say, God, I need you now. I'm at my wit's end. I let go of trying to control this. I need you. I need your help. Look at Moses one more time. If you remember his story, Moses perhaps felt a lot like some of us right now. And here's something very interesting. I don't know how often any of you read different blogs or anything like that, but if you go on blogs and you start searching for the phrase, God will not give you more than you can handle, you will see something very interesting to emerge. While looking at this on my own, out of about 50 different blogs, I'm going to estimate about 45 of those blogs were written by women. And you could hear this desperation coming out of women who think about it, raising children, doing the lion's share of work at home. Often, you know, they're paying the bills, or they're trying to juggle a job and a career, and they have children and all this other stuff. And these women, they try to talk themselves into this false belief that if I have all of these things going on, it means that God thinks I can handle it. No, that's not the case. He's allowing you to have all of these things so that we stop thinking that we can handle it. And there is this sense of fear and desperation and in inadequacy where they think, oh, you know, I should be able to do all of this. I know God is not going to give me more than I can handle. I just can't, you know, Miss Perfect Hair over there, she can do all of this, and here I am struggling with the simple things in life. And Moses felt exactly like that, and you can hear almost this panic in his voice, in his words. Numbers 11:15, he says this to God, if this is how you are going to treat me, put me to death right now. If I haven't found favor in your eyes and you do not let me face my own ruin, I cannot take it anymore. Verse 16, the Lord said to Moses, bring me 70 of Israel's elders, and I will take the spirit that is on you and put the spirit on them. They will help you carry the burden of the people so that you will not have to carry it alone. Because we are not designed to live life on our own. God will not give us more than we can handle, is the question. The truth is, God often allows us to have more than we can handle, and He loves to give us the gift of too much. Three things that this gift teaches us, and I hope that you will act on this lesson, on the lessons of this gift. The first one, God gives us the gift of too much because it teaches us how to put something down. When we have so many options, the gift of too much teaches us to prioritize. It's a lot like going to a great buffet. Now, some buffets are fantastic, and others are just simply gross. You know, you go to some of those buffets where the food's been sitting out for like 3 hours, and it's dry and it's nasty. But a Chinese buffet or an Indian buffet, oh, I love. You know what? Quaker steak. has the most fantastic lunch buffet. It is, you know, hearkening back to our verse earlier, it's just meat. There's like a whole line of meat. There's like a little salad thing off by itself that no one ever goes to. But they have, you know, just sausage and fries and burgers and hot dogs and pulled pork and chicken strips and chicken wings, all this wonderful stuff at their lunch buffet. What is significant about these buffets, with so many good choices, it forces us to take only the things that we really, really want. Because you cannot go up four or five times to get a new plate. Trust me, I used to do that in college. And people stare and point when they walk by again, like, man, that's like the fifth time he's gone up there. They count. So now I limit myself to two plates. And then, you know, you always have the dessert run there. But so I'm standing at this counter looking at all of this food, and I can only take the things that I really, really want. The things that I have valued at, you know, I enjoy this more, and so I'm going to turn this part away. I'm going to let go. I'm not going to have it. Here's what we need to think about in our life. You know, I have a daily blessing of the gift of too much. Three children, and let me tell you right now, they are too much in a good way. If I were to try to spend half an hour with each child individually, that's an hour and a half out of, you know, the 4 or 5 hours that I have at home with them after the work and school day. It cannot be fit into my schedule. We just cannot do that. We cannot take an hour and a half every day to spend this time with them. I wake up daily with this gift of too much. And what it does for me is it forces me to then prioritize. What are the things that are most important? A lot of people may think that their pastor or they themselves can handle everything. You can have all of these things going on. And I simply refuse to live life that way. If right now you are hurting because you've gone too long with too many things on your plate, let the Spirit of God begin to show you how you can let go of some things, to put some things down. There is a classic story in Luke 10. Jesus is visiting the home of Mary and Martha, and they get confused on some different things. Martha, if you remember her story, she thought that she could do it all. She thought that she could have the house perfect, have it smelling good, and have all the perfect dishes out, and then later on she would be able to spend some time with Jesus. But then she started to freak out like a lot of us do because she was becoming overwhelmed. She was trying to do it all. And Luke 10, 41, Jesus spoke this to her. And he said, "Martha, Martha, you are worried and upset about many, many things." Verse 42, "But only one thing is needed. Mary had chosen what is better, and it will not be taken away from her." The gift of too much forces us to prioritize. What is the most important thing? Now, if you will, I'm going to give you just a real quick, you know, little side note here on how we can really see this gift develop in our lives. When we have too much, one of the things that we can begin to do is we can learn how to say or instead of and. It's all about that conjunction. You know, remember the song, Conjunction, Junction, what's your function? Hooking up words and phrases and clauses. Okay, so say this with me. Too much, it teaches us to say or. Say or. Learn how to say or instead of and. What do most people do? Well, I can do this, and I can do that, and I can do this and this thing, and we can get our kids here and there, and we can have this thing, and I can be a wife, and I can be a mom, and I can be a dad, and a professional, and an executive, and a soccer mom, and I can have this and this and this. The gift of too much forces us to start to say or. One of the most important leadership principles that I have learned is that word, or. I wake up daily. Greg, how are you going to get all of these things done today? I don't. I don't even try to get everything done. God gives me the gift of too much, and just because I could do more doesn't mean that I should do more. I look at the things in my schedule and I say, okay, I can do this or I can do that. And I need to prioritize. Just because you think that you can do it all does not mean that God has called you to do it all. If you wake up with too much on your schedule already, start to learn how to say or. Instead of adding to your do list, to your to-do list, most people think that highly productive people have a really big to-do list. Instead of adding more to that list, maybe what you should do is add to your to-don't list. This is the realization that we have too much going on in our lives. And if I try to do it all, what I end up doing is I miss the most important things in my life. Talk to someone who is, 60, 70 years old. They've poured their life into their career. They've watched their children just swing right on by out of the house, and they missed it. And they will tell you they should have learned how to say or instead of and. I can work more or I can go to the game. I can take my children out on the trampoline or I can do more work on my sermon. It's not and, it is or. It is a gift of too much. And if you are there, then let the Holy Spirit of God begin to lead you in determining what are the priorities. And I really want to stress, what are His priorities, not our own? Please do not take this as an excuse to watch more TV or spend more time on the phone or to read more. I'm not talking about that. You cannot work 60 hours plus a week and have children and have a household to take care of and serve in ministry and on the PTA and take your children to baseball and then take them to soccer and then to dance class and then to scouting and then to music class and then to tutoring. We cannot do those things. We need to seek His priorities and let this gift teach us how to say or. So that's thought number one. First thing, God teaches us how to put something down. Second thing that He does is He teaches us how to hand something off, how to delegate, to give something away. Again, Moses, another time in Scripture, like many of us, was feeling overwhelmed. And all of these people, from morning until evening that he was leading, they wanted his advice on some different things. They wanted him to settle their arguments. They wanted him to give him his counsel and direction on their lives. And his life was beginning to fall apart because he believed that he could do it all. God will never give me more than I can handle. Surely I can handle these 2 million problems every single day. So Jethro, his father-in-law, speaks up, and in Exodus 18, verse 17, he says this, "Moses, what you are doing is not good. Maybe the Spirit of God will speak to you, to some of you in some way today, and maybe that is what his message is to us. What you are doing is not good. You and these people who come to you, you're only going to wear yourselves out. This work is too heavy for you. You cannot handle it alone." So Jethro gave him some good advice. He said, "Go find some godly men, some people whose word is good, that they cannot be bought. They are people of integrity and have some oversee thousands of people and have another group under them oversee hundreds, another group oversee 50s, another group oversee 10s. In other words, begin to spread yourself out. We are going to hand some things off because God did not design us to do it all. God often gives us the gift of too much so that we can learn how to make this handoff. The problem is too many of us, if you are like me, we are too full of pride to actually say to someone, can you help me with this? 5 or 6 years ago, we had a really bad snowstorm. I'm sure you remember it. It was on a Friday night into Saturday. The entire city of Pittsburgh was shut down for like a week. Our oldest, Caleb, was in kindergarten at the time, so he was out of school for a week. About 2 feet of snow fell. Saturday afternoon comes around, and the snow has finally finished. You know, we live right on Salzburg Road, a very busy road. And I venture out there with Caleb and Eden behind me, and I go out to start shoveling. Now, if you've been to our house, we have a pretty fairly long driveway uphill. And the last thing I wanted to do was shovel this thing by myself. We didn't have a snowblower or anything like that. So I head out, and what I do is I go down to the bottom where the road and the driveway meet. And I start shoveling, and I'm shoveling for like 45 minutes, and I've cleared a space about 4 feet by 4 feet. And, you know, so I'm standing in this hole, and Caleb and Eden are standing in this hole as well, and I'm looking at our entire driveway, and I'm thinking, it's impossible. I will never be able to do this. I go inside, and I tell Nicole, and she says, well, what if I need to get out? And the answer is, you're not. We're not leaving. We're stuck here. Sunday, I call someone to pick me up for worship, and then on Monday, I go down to the road, and I'm just standing there with money. And every time I see a plow go by, I'm like waving this money at them because I knew that I needed help. I needed someone else to do it. So I needed to learn how to hand something off. And not just the physical pressure that we may face about things, but maybe you need to share and hand off some of these emotional burdens as well. And that's hard for a lot of us to do because we want to appear strong. I don't want anyone to know when I am hurting. I don't want anyone to know when I am overwhelmed. But did you know that you cannot fully experience the glory of the presence of God on our own as much as we can in relationship with someone else? Whenever two or three are gathered in his name, he is there in the midst of them. He obviously referring to God. And some of us right now, we believe that God will not give us more than we can handle, so we do not open up and we do not say to people, look, I need your help. It's time to put something down, and it's time to hand something off. And this is what Moses did in verse 22 and 23 of Exodus 18. He handed some things off, and Jethro said that that will make your load lighter, because they will share it with you, and you will be able to stand the strain, and all of these people will go home satisfied. Put something down, hand something off, and number three, give something to God. Give something to God. The challenge for so many of us is that we believe that we can do it all, especially if someone says that we cannot. You can't do it. Oh, yes, I can, is the typical thinking. When I was in the hospital, the nurse was trying to get me, it was just for an appendix, and the nurse was trying to get me to breathe into that anti-pneumonia thingy. I don't know what it's called. And what she said is, you know, guys cannot keep the little ball above this line for more than 10 seconds. And I'm like, all right, it's on. It's a challenge. And she probably knew full well what she was doing using reverse psychology, and I was determined. I'm like, no, I'm going to keep 20 seconds, you know. Kind of. Meanwhile, it's probably like the most simplest thing in the world, but she's making a big deal of it. White men can't jump. When I saw that movie, I became determined to be able to grab one rim. I knew I would never be able to dunk. I just, you know, there was only one Spud Webb. But I would be able to jump. So after 2 summers of playing beach volleyball, this white boy could grab rim. You know, that was 20 years ago. And I won't even say how many pounds ago. But we cannot do it all. We just cannot. Ask the people who have lived life for a while. That's a nice way of saying, ask the older people here. Can you do it all? And they are going to be like, no, there's no way that you can do it all. Just stop it. What are you holding on to right now that God says, if you let go, I will carry this for you? What are we holding on to because we are believing in this old urban legend that God will not give us more than we can handle, and he has allowed us to have more than we can handle so that we can learn in a greater way to depend more on his strength and on his goodness. Now, I have an illustration to talk about with this. One of the things that we read in the Bible, Psalm 55:22. Cast our cares on the Lord, and he will sustain us. The Hebrew word for cast is this word shalach, and it means exactly that, to cast. It was something that fishermen would do. Now, I had asked, because I do not have a fishing rod, I had asked someone in the church here to bring one of theirs. And just to show how long it's been since I've been fishing, I had asked him, well, where's like the button? Like, you know, I remember growing up with the fishing rods, there was like a little button. You press that and you could throw it out. So he explained how to do this, and I'm not about to try. I tried it twice. I hit the door, and then right where Alan is sitting, I hit the chair. So I'm not going to cast this. But you know, as a fisherman, there is a big difference between casting and just plopping your line down in the water. And Jesus Christ tells us, or the Bible in Proverbs or Psalms tells, we read to cast our cares. It means to hurl something, throw it as far away from us as possible. So if you have a burden, if you have more than you can handle, put something down, give something away, and cast it onto God. Throw it onto him. Cast your cares upon him because he cares for you and he will sustain you. I like the story of the Apostle Paul in the New Testament when he actually had too much. And in 2 Corinthians 12, you can read this story where he had what he calls a thorn in his side. And we are not sure what exactly that was. Scholars debate about it one way or the other. But he begged God three different times, God, will you please take this thing away from me? I cannot handle it. It is too much. God, take it away. And 2 Corinthians 12, verse 9, God says to him, my grace is sufficient for you, and my power is made perfect in weakness. The power of God is made perfect when we come to the end of our strength and we are completely weak. Satan wants you to believe that God will not give you more than you can handle. That is Satan. That is not Scripture. It's an urban legend. It's a myth. The truth is, God allows us to have more than we can handle. I used to think this. With everything in me, I used to think I have to be strong for my wife. I have to be strong for my children. I have to be strong for you, the church. I have to be strong for those that I lead. I have to be strong for my friends. And that is an absolute lie. Because the truth is, I have to be weak. I have to be weak. I have to be broken. I have to daily go before God and say, you know what? I cannot do that. Do this. I do not have the power. Thank you for giving me the gift of too much. It teaches me to learn and depend upon you. Now, some may hear that and they think, well, that's, you know, I don't want to show weakness. But it's about showing faith. It's about having faith in Jesus Christ that he is going to do the thing that he wants us to do. How could any Christian, how could any man live a way where he says, no, I want to be weak, I want to be broken? So I'll give you the example of Polycarp. You know, carp kind of playing on the whole fishing theme, I guess. But Polycarp was this incredible person, Christian, that lived in the area of Smyrna, way back in 155 AD. The enemies of Christ were killing believers. And they said to Polycarp, who at the time was 86 years old, He was a hero to many, and what they said to him is, deny Christ, and we will let you live. All you have to do is say, Caesar is Lord. And Polycarp said probably the most famous line of his at 86. He says, 86 years Christ has been faithful to me. He has never done me any wrong. How could I deny and blaspheme the King who saved me? And so they said, okay, instead of throwing you to the lions, we are going to burn you at the stake. And they did. And they also included his loved ones and his friends. Tradition tells us some others were saying, how are we going to know that you are okay? And at 86 years old, he says, God's grace is going to be sufficient for me. I cannot go through this on my own. All I can do is trust in God's grace. When they burn me and when I am dying, I will hold up one finger to show you as a symbol that God's grace is enough. So they tie him to the stake, and they put the wood around him, and they lit the fire. And the women are screaming, the guys are trying to be strong, and they smelled the aroma of his death. And before he died, tradition says that Polycarp, he held up one finger and said, God's grace is enough. And then his disciples looked on and they said, look at that, he's doing this. God is revealing his grace to him. And then right before his death, he held up another finger, you know, kind of as a way to say that God's grace, it's more than enough. More than enough to give me the strength that I need, that when I am at my weakest, he is at his strongest. So we need to stop trying to be so strong and really trust in Christ for our strength. Will you pray with me? Father, we ask that in your holy presence, Lord, that we would embrace those times when you give us the gift of too much. And that gift, that you would teach us how to prioritize things, how to put things down, to hand something off, and to give everything we possibly can to you. God, some of us right now, we would say, you know what? I am barely hanging on, and I'm in a survival mode, and I feel like I'm doing this over and over and over again. It's not right, it's not healthy, and I've tried to do it all, and I'm recognizing now that maybe you have allowed me to have too much so that I could put something down, add something to my to-don't list. Maybe I need to hand something off and say, God, I need your help. I need counseling. I need care. I need assistance. I need more out of you. I need help. And there are those others that are going to recognize that we have been trying to do this all on our own, that we believe that our strength is enough to get us through. And God, we pray that you would break us of that, because we know that when we think that we can do it, all that we are doing is hindering your power in our lives. God, we do not want to try to be strong for everyone else. We want to be broken before you so that you can be strong through us, because we know that in our own power, in our own abilities, with our own words and our own actions, it's never enough. But God, you can change us and make us live as you would have us to live. And the moment we do that, God, we know that it is your strength, that they are your words. And God, your grace is more than enough. So God, we know that if there are things in our lives that are weighing upon us that we need to let go, God, we pray that we would be able to do that. Even right now as we sit here and we pray before you, we know that your Holy Spirit is telling us those things that we need to let go, things that are not a priority, and they are certainly not one of your priorities. God, help us to be brave enough to let go. God, help us to prioritize our lives and see the things that we need to do, those times that we need to make that decision of or, and to stop saying and to so much in life. God, help us to be different. Help us to live different lives in our neighborhoods and in our communities where people can look to us and say, why is it that you seem to have it managed with all of this stuff going on in life? God, may the work that you have been doing in our lives be the thing that serves as an example to others, to encourage others to say there is a better way of living. And it is found by living life in you. So God, may you help us to be those people. And may we be willing to understand that we need you in this life. We thank you and we love you. And it's in the name of Jesus Christ we pray. Amen.
Visit us on the web at www.rollinghillschurch.today or drop in for a visit at 120 Gurner Drive, Verona, PA 15147. Service time is 10 a.m. on Sunday. Send us a message via email to rollinghillsbaptist@comcast.net or reach us by phone at 412-795-1133.